All right, so our next piece is Petra Jordan. So if you're looking at the dates, 400 BCE, I threw you back into BCE. Yes, I did. And this is a mistake that I make every year, and every year I remind myself to fix this, and I don't do it. So this is obviously in Jordan, thus the name Petra Jordan. There should be a comma there. Petra is the city, Jordan's the country. But it's made during basically the Hellenistic period of Greece. So I really should put it sometime. It was later taken over by the Romans. I really should put it more in the classical section, even though it's not Greece or Rome. But that's okay. I mess it up every year. So, and you'll see why I think I should put it in the classical section in just a moment. So, let's see here. Petra, the word Petra, the name for the city. Again, there should be a comma there. That's my fault. Sorry. Petra means rock. And you'll see a lot of rock here, as indicated by this first image, which I know doesn't look like much. But when we get a shot of the other ones, you'll see it's pretty extraordinary. It was once thought to be a necropolis. What's the word necropolis? You know what a necropolis is. Necropolis. Polis means city. Necro means dead. City of the dead. So a city, basically a burial city. But it was not a necropolis at all. It was a very, very busy city. And the reason it was busy was because of trade, because the Nabataeans were on a very important, and I think they controlled trade routes for spices. We'll get into that in a second. Yes, we're controlled luxury trade in incense, not spices, but incense, which I could, during the late Hellenistic period and early Roman period. It used to be extremely lush. There were fountains and villas, and it was very wealthy. Well, why was incense such a big deal? Doesn't seem like that'd be a big deal. Guys, I don't have deodorant back then. No, the bathing is not so it's not as easy to happen, right? So incense is important because things can stink. So the Hellenistic period, as you recall, when you think back to the Hellenistic period, of course you think about the winged victory of Samothrace. You think about the great altar of Zeus and Athena at Pergamon. You think about maybe the seated boxer. You think about that movement, right? That incredible movement that we and drama that we associate with the Hellenistic period. The Hellenistic is from Alexander the Great to about when the Roman Empire starts making its appearance on the world stage. It's not really the empire there, so I shouldn't say Roman Empire. I should say kind of Roman Republic. So Hellenistic isn't just referring to works in Greece. Hellenistic, again, is going to be a general style because the Greek Empire was so expansive. There was lots of influences from lots of different places, and Greece's influence went a lot of different places. So Hellenistic is not just reserved to things done in Greece by Greeks, right? So it's referring to artistic and cultural similarities in the eastern part of the Mediterranean and Egypt and the Middle East. And we'll see that again in greater detail in just a moment. Most of the big, important, memorable ones were built before the Roman Empire took over in 106. So eventually, it never belonged to Greece, although we see a lot of things that remind us of Greece visually, right? We associate it with Hellenistic style, though it never belonged to Greece. They were their own thing, the Nabataeans. Okay. Then the Romans took over around 100 CE. All right. I'll give you this link to this map, a kind of a Google tour. I highly, highly recommend you do it. There are little dots on it that give you some audio that you should actually, let me go ahead and do this so I can show you. It's really important that you do it. Discover Petra. That should look familiar. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. So the trek is best experienced with headphones.
This
Yes.
is
Yes.
Alkazma,
All
or
right.
the Treasury. Its impressive 40-meter high facade.
Okay, I'm gonna put her on silent. So you'll see there's a map here. Okay. So you can follow this map and click on as many as you like, but you definitely need to click on the treasury for sure. Where's the treasury? It's on there someplace. Where is it? Am I here? There it is. The treasury. Click on the treasury for sure. Click on gateway to the Sikh or Sikh, I think. And I would look through some of this as well, just so you get a good sense of the movement through the rock to get to Petra. And so definitely the treasury, do the colonnaded streets and I was hoping they had something else. Yeah, just choose a few. But definitely look at the treasury and the colonnaded street and the beginning of the road. Okay, so I'm going to close this because I don't need it back here. All right. So Petra, again, capital of the Nabatean kingdom for most of the history of until the Roman Empire came in, Trajan specifically. And Trajan moved the capital to Syria, moved the capital of this area to Syria. So it kind of fell, away in importance. And right. So if you've seen any Greek theaters before or pictures of Greek theaters, you'll recognize this. This is a Greek style theater, the amphitheater, right, with the incredible acoustics. This you may have seen before if you have watched Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, because it was used as where the cup, the chalice from the Last Supper was hidden. So it's identified as the treasury. It is not a treasury. It was likely a tomb for a king. It was identified as a treasury because it looks maybe kind of like a bank. So we can see definitely the Hellenistic architectural style. What do I mean by that? So we see, if we just look at this half, the lower half, it very much looks like a Greek temple, doesn't it? Think back to the Parthenon, right? This looks like the Parthenon a little bit, a little more elaborate, or maybe the great temple of the great altar of Zeus and Athena, right? We have Corinthian columns. I see a frieze. I see a pediment, right? There are also sculptures of Greek gods. You don't need to know the gods' names, but there are sculptures of Greek gods here. On the upper half, we also have another pediment, but this is called a broken pediment because it's obviously not doesn't go all the way up. It's obviously intentionally broken, and it's broken by a tholos, a tholos, excuse me, a tholos, which is a cylinder shape here. So we also have up here the beginnings of two obelisks. I don't know if it was intentionally not fully completed, or if it was just or if it was they just ran out of time or money or whatever. We also have figures of bare-breasted Amazons and victory goddesses, or victory goddess. So we've got a lot of things that we associate with Greece. But remember, Greek culture was spread far and wide during the Hellenistic period, and there was lots of influence of Greek culture on other places and other places' influences on Greek culture. That's Hellenism, okay? All right. So says here, the Nabataeans took an active role in their architectural and artistic creations, drawing upon the artistic vocabulary of the Hellenistic world and the ancient Near East. But at the same time, it doesn't look exactly like what you'd see in Greece, right? I'm focusing mostly on Greece because I think that that's what we really see the most of here. It doesn't look exactly like what we'd see in Greece. It has its own flair, all right? So they adopted certain elements that they liked. They changed things. They combined things. So it's not just a copy of Greek style. It's its own thing. And it's the whole city's carved out of rock. So and made out of rock, right? This is identified as the Great Temple. We don't know if it was a great temple. It could have been an audience hall. Or maybe we could think about that as an oppidanna, right? If we remember the audience hall of Darius and Xerxes. But we're not entirely sure. There is a Smithsonian article I'll want you to read. And there's a video from UNESCO that I'll want you to watch. This video isn't super necessary for you to watch, but it is interesting, especially if you have interest in geology and how they keep these places stable. Because sometimes rocks get cracks in them, and it's really pretty interesting. So this isn't absolutely necessary for you to watch, but you know, if you are interested, you can. But the UNESCO video and the Smithsonian article are necessary. Okay, thanks a bunch.